Hi, this is Dave Castle with the fourth in a series of videos about using Roxy to build and deploy applications with MarkLogic. In this video, we're going to see how to work with indexes and lexicons. If you're following along doing the steps with me, I'm assuming that you've created and bootstrapped a hybrid application based on the dev branch. So here we are in the admin UI. I've got my application set up with the HTTP servers, my server, the databases, so on. Let's take a look here in the content database, and we'll see that there are a few different types of range indexes we can have. There are element, attribute, field, path, and geospatial indexes, as well as element and attribute word lexicons. A common error when you're working with multiple environments is having different indexes on your different servers. With Roxy, we can avoid that. Your indexes and lexicons will be defined in the mlconfig.xml file, and they'll be created with the bootstrap command. Roxy provides two ways to set up the indexes. There's an interview method that works for element and attribute range indexes, and there's the manual method, which works for any kind of index or lexicon. To give this series of tutorials a little bit of color, I decided to pick an application that we're going to work with, and I'll use that throughout the series of tutorials. So I decided to go with a little hobby site I built a while ago to keep track of souvenir pins and stuff like that that I get. So we can see just from looking at the UI that I've got facets on the owner, the date on which I got the souvenir, and what kind of souvenir it is. There's also a geospatial index that lets me take a look at where I got the different things. Now, this is one example document showing the kind of content we're going to have. So we're going to build a couple indexes now. I'm going to start with doing one on the owner element here. Now the approach I'll use for this first one is the interview process that I mentioned. As a quick reminder, if we do a minus H on the ML script, it'll remind us of the available commands. And we're going to use the index command. Further, we can say minus L, ML index minus H and get a little bit more info there about how to use it. In this case, it's pretty simple, just ML index, and it will ask enough questions to get us going from there. We're going to build an element range index, so I'll choose 1. It's a string, so I'll choose 17. The namespace URI that I picked is this, and the local name of the element is owner. For the collation, I could just hit enter and go with the root collation, but I'm going to use the code point one instead. Not interested in range value position, so I'm going to leave that off. So now Roxy presents to me the XML that defines the index that I've just asked for. And it's going to put this into mlconfig for me. So it's just basically, this is a confirmation step to make sure that we're getting what we think we're getting. Looks right to me, so I'm going to say yes. And my next step is I'm going to bootstrap again. Now, I bootstrapped originally to create the application servers and the database and so on. When I bootstrap again, well, basically the bootstrap command applies the current configuration to the server. So if the application's not on the server, it'll add it. If it's already there, it'll update the configuration. I've had people ask me if it's safe to run the bootstrap command on an existing project. The answer is generally yes. Most of the time, you're doing that because you're changing a couple settings, maybe adding an index or something like that. Now, you do have to be careful about if you've got a very large database and you add an index, that will trigger a re-indexing, which could be a lot of work. And you might want to, on a production system, you might want to think about when you do that. There are other ways that you need to be a little bit careful. For instance, if you've set up your application, let's say with four content, with four forests, and then you change your configuration to have two forests, then when you bootstrap, two of those forests are going to go away along with the data that's in them. So you want to be careful, but generally speaking, yes, this is how you apply changes to the configuration. So coming back to the admin UI, we can see that the owner element has been created. And if we take a look in the mlconfig.xml file, we can scroll down to the databases section. Note that I'm looking at the content DB section here. And if I go down a little bit farther, we'll get to the range element indexes part of this. And we'll see the XML that was just created for us in that interview process. Now, to show you that that is the same as the manual process, let's do the manual process for the type element. For each of the different types of indexes available, there's a comment in the mlconfig.xml giving you an example of how to define that type. So I'm just going to paste that. I do want a string, so that's fine. The comments are set up with the code point collation, so I'm going to stick with that. Not interested in range value positions for this one, so that's fine. And there it is. That's all you have to do. Similarly, I need some range element attribute indexes. So what I'll do is just copy this. And in this case, I'm interested in a date. Now, because this is a date, the collation doesn't matter. So I'll drop that part out. Now, the date, you might remember from my example document, I've got start and end attributes here on this element. That's because I couldn't always remember exactly when I got something, but this way I can give a range. Now I've got the start and end covered. So the last part that I want to do is get the geospatial index set up. So we can see here I've got a location element that's got a lat child and a long child. Sometimes this is how this information will be structured. Other times you'll find it as attributes on a particular element. There are different ways to do this. So to reflect that, as we look down in here and find the geospatial elements, the geospatial indexes, we're going to see that not only is there a commented out example configuration, but there's also a comment that shows what kind of data this applies to. In this particular case, that's where you've got a couple of attributes. That's not what I'm looking for. Here we go. That one matches what I have in my database, or the data structure that I want to use. Okay, so I've gotten that to match up with the data structure that I've chosen. I've added a few different indexes. So again, I'm going to go in here and bootstrap. Now, in this case, I don't actually have any data in my database yet, so bootstrapping is not going to trigger any reindexing. If you do have reindexing, then it probably makes sense to do all of your indexes and then kick it off once. And there we have it. So at this point, we have created the indexes we want. Let's take a look. We've got owner, type. We've got our start and end attribute indexes on acquired date. And we've got geospatial index. The geospatial index on the element pair is set up. The exact same process will work fine for path range indexes, field indexes, and the word lexicons too. In each case, all you have to do is find the right section with the commented out examples, copy those, and paste them and adjust them to be what you need. Likewise, if you need to delete an index, the thing to do is come into this file, find where you defined that index, and remove that from this file. As an example, I could find my geospatial index that I set up earlier. So I can select this, delete it, and then when I save the file and bootstrap again, it will remove this index from the database. So there's one last step we need to do, which is to make sure we capture our changes. We've changed the deploy mlconfig.xml file, and here in Git GUI we can see what's different. So stage that commit. And there we go. All right, so that's it for this video. Thanks for watching.